welcome to season two of the Cinema Sitdown. Me and my guests just watched last night.
Mom, I made a decision about where I want to be when it happens, and I'm sorry, but you're going to have to accept that.
It's a 1998 film. Basically, the world's ending in a couple of hours. It starts at 6 p.m. It ends at midnight. And the movie just kind of follows these people and their interactions. They're all interconnected in some way or another. And how everybody reacts to the end of the world, having the situation where anything, ever like all morality is thrown out the window. Any preconceptions that they got from society is thrown out of the world. First, we can introduce our guests. We'll start on my left here.
I'm Alexis.
How's it going? It's me, Paris. Welcome. Glad to be back for season two.
And I am your host, Jane Abernathy. So I'll get the conversation started.
Get the crowd rolling.
Get the crowd rolling. This movie followed a lot of different stories with a lot of different people. To start at the very beginning with the family, the mom and the dad and her grandparents having dinner with their grandchildren. And that's where we initially learn that the world's ending. Just going into that scene, what were your preconceptions about the film? What were you expecting versus whenever they started talking about the end of the world?
Yeah, so at the beginning, I was like really lost, which I think is like pretty kind of set you up for that, of like this, not necessarily knowing what's going on exactly, but then kind of slowly, you kind of grasp the concept and the idea kind of like piece by piece. And I think that was a good choice rather than having like some kind of title that like explains there's some narrator coming in and explain it. So, but yeah, going from there and like piecing together everything, ultimately to me, I felt like it was just kind of like an exploration, like a case study on human nature. And I feel like there's a lot of psychological things about the film, and ultimately it's just about like human nature and human morality and what people do in these circumstances of, you know, death and throughout their life.
Yeah, and one of the things you just brought up was how they presented kind of their story and what the situation that these people are in, which is one of my favorite parts about the film. Was that it all came off like so like incredibly natural feeling. It came off so like we're all like, this is actually what people would do and what would happen, which is one of the things that I love about the presentation of this movie, that it really just like it drags you into like the reality of the situation and gets you into these people's headspace, which helps so much. So, you know, in the first scene of the film, we see them kind of acting like nothing is happening, and whenever their son Patrick finally brings it up, hey, it's the end of the world, everyone starts to freak out and like, we're not trying
to
think about this.
They're like in doubt, like they don't want to have to think about like, oh, in a couple hours, like we're all gonna be dead, like nothing's gonna come of this.
Pretending like it's a normal night with the family.
Yeah, it was like Christmas or whatever.
They were pretending it was
Christmas. Yeah, they were pretending it was Christmas. Yeah. They got all their childhood gifts back and had a fancy dinner with a lamb. Yeah. That looked really gross, by the way.
Your mother.
What a bird.
Again, I think it's just like down to really cheap production.
It seemed
very low budget, so I guess catering wasn't on set that day. But yeah, they're just kind of like trying to, that's like our first case, is like pretending like it's not happening at all. And just sort of ignoring that reality in favor of
that,
pretending
like,
that everything is okay and happy.
Yeah, and that and wanting him to stay, Patrick, the one of, I guess, like the main character.
Yeah, he's the focal point that everyone else revolves around a little bit.
They really wanted him to stay, and they're really upset that he was like, no, I'm leaving, like this is what I want to do. And I think that's when we got into all the other people and stuff. And
so I think one thing that I thought was really interesting was Patrick, the character himself, because he's, again, he's sort of the focal point which all these other people revolve around. He interacts with almost everyone in the story at some point or another. He's the only, like, through point from story to story. Otherwise, it'd just be, like, a straight anthology, and he's the connecting point between all these little links. What exactly does Patrick represent at the beginning of the story, and what's his arc to the end? So I want to get your guys' opinion on what he represents to the wider story.
For him specifically, I think that he probably represents some kind of like link between all these different people. Another character that comes to my mind is the guy. I don't know his name, but the guy who was calling everyone for the gas company. Mm-hmm. I think it kind of represents this absurdity of, you know, the world is ending and he's still going to his 9-to-5.
Yeah.
And like kind of a bit of critique on maybe capitalism or, you know, so just society.
I think it was more saying like, talking about like the comforts of your daily life and your routine. Because he goes on his 9-to-5 and then he goes home, like Yo-Yo says, eats his bucket of ice cream and cries into it. It's just another one of these case scenarios where monotony is your rock. It's what makes you comfortable, and that's why people are still going and doing this even though the world's ending, and doing their jobs. It's familiar. I want to know your opinion. What do you think that Patrick represents in the wider context of the story?
I feel like it's like for him, he's just like nothing else matters anymore. Like the world is ending and he's just there. Like he's just waiting for it to happen. I mean, he interacts with all these people, like one, you know, his family wants him to stay, his friend wants to have sex with him. The lady just wants to get home, and then towards the end, like wants to do the suicide pact that she had, and he agrees to that eventually. And I mean, they had the conversation about him. He was a widower, and like she was like, make me fall in love with you, and that was like his last, I feel like, real connection that he'd made. Like it showed him actually genuinely like caring about somebody, because he was like, you can stay, blah blah blah.
Yeah, because he didn't really care too much about his mom. He didn't seem to have any particular love for his
siblings.
Like,
he was just there. Like he was the character that was connecting everybody, but him within himself, he was just there.
Like, he was lacking connection. And then after, I think you're right, after sort of meeting all these people and who he didn't quite feel connections with, or
one
something
just kept
that he was
reappearing.
Acting. One just kept reappearing, this woman, Sandra. And at the end, he finally sort of made that connection. And it's this like really beautiful moment of peace where the music flares up and we can hear everyone singing and everybody's final moments is, but eventually just the music fades out and it's just these two in an embrace. The point of it all, I think that what they were trying to say is human connection. Because at the very end, everyone was with somebody else, whether they knew them, whether they didn't know them.
Well,
people were in the streets
that's like
cheering.
It's like the point of like humans thrive off of human connection. I mean, even now in real world with everything that's gone on, like people really want to get out there and be with other people. Like you go insane being by yourself. And I mean, there's the studies about that and everything.
Yeah.
And it's also, I feel like to show with the... I mean, it's from,
1998.
According to Google, it was 1999 when I was looking up the director's name, to which I still can't remember. It was like, phones were down. Like, there was just no, like, real social media or anything. Like, phones were down. They couldn't get a hold of people because they talked about, like, the car phone. They're like, oh, that's still down. Like, that's been down for months. So it was like, you take that all away, and it's like, what do you really have?
And, you know, people... grasp to these little things like their job or their cars.
Like people were still getting a job. There was the one about the car. The guy didn't want to give the car, even though he wasn't going anywhere.
These little things that like help them feign happiness, but isn't actually bringing them happiness.
He was the
concert.
Pianist,
You know, but at the end, everyone sort of ends up with that human connection. The teacher and the guy at the piano concert have a little connection through their music. Obviously, Patrick and Sandra have their moment at the end. The sex guy, I forget his name.
I don't know his name. It's just...
He was a special character, but
he died
in the arms of, you know, another woman.
A virgin.
Of a virgin. Maybe a little bit biblical. I think that's a good conclusion to come to, like, what the through point of the movie was. For what was obviously a at the very least, an indie production. They used the space and the script that they had expertly. And what I always appreciate about indie productions, and as a lot of it's evident in like a lot of directors' early work, Tarantino with Reservoir Dogs, Coen Brothers with Blood Simple, is that they're able to use their space really well and what they actually have available. It really puts into perspective that, Elena, a little lesson about filmmaking, that you don't have to have like $1 million to make something impressive, to make like a meaningful and impactful story.
I really like the scene where he brought his friend into, I think it was his kitchen, and there's just writing all over the walls, and he was like, he was like freaking out. He's like,
take a look at this. I tried to ask myself, what did I want? What were those experiences that I had hoped for, which were now just passing me by? And I made a list. I made a comprehensive list, and then I went out and I actively tried to meet those goals. And as you can see, it wasn't that hard.
He's going a little insane, and he was like, this is what I really wanted, you know, like trying to proposition his friend. But
so what do we think about Patrick's friend there? Of course, he's a little sex crazy at that point. And he's got this little serial killer thing in his kitchen where he's writing down every single sex act.
I feel like it's like when you like
commit.
When you ask somebody, it's like, oh, what do you really want to do? And then that's like what somebody would say. Oh, I want to go out having sex. try all these different things. Like, oh, I haven't done this yet. I want to die before I do this.
Yeah, so he's like a bucket list kind of guy.
Yeah, I guess. Just a little.
Yeah, I think he represents a certain side of, like how I said earlier, with, I think the movie is very just like a case study of human nature. So I think he represents one certain aspect of human nature magnified to where it's like, this obsession of his, and he has all these, with the wall, he has like all these things, is like bucket list, as we said. And it's just like that's such a big part of human nature, obviously, because that's how we're all here. So it's like, But then he like absurdifies it and, kind of becomes obsessed with that aspect of it.
Yeah, and kind of maybe loses some of, he sort of loses the meaning of what he's doing in favor of personal pleasures. It's sort of going primal in a way.
Well, I feel like towards the end though, he had a moment where he was just like, I can't do this. And she was like, what do you mean? And he was like, it's not you.
Yeah.
And
he's then, like, it wasn't fulfilling him.
Yeah, it wasn't fulfilling. And then they just went back at it. But it was like, he had like a split second where he was like, wait a second. Because it was like really close to midnight. And he was like, do I really want to do this?
But there were just a couple like little scenes in there that like, is this supposed to be a dark comedy? Like the scene where they like zoom in on what's actually in the kitchen. I thought it was very comedically timed, and I started giggling to myself. Yeah. And again, the scene with the mother and...
Or when he's sleeping with the first girl, and she's like...
I just want you to know that I'm not doing this because you're black.
Yes, you are. You don't have to lie.
Yeah.
Like, okay. Legitimately.
Like, that was just said, that it cut to somebody else, and I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah, there is a lot of little moments, and that's one of the things about the script, is that it's able to present so many emotions, like this really heartfelt moment at the end, and I hope that these little bits were meant to be comedic. I think they were.
I think they were, because you don't want something to be so serious, especially if, like, at a topic like that, because... It's supposed to be like the end of the millennial, so it's like, okay, well, not everybody's gonna be like so depressed.
So, one thing was Sandra and her husband, who we'd never actually meet, their plan was to commit suicide as the world ended, or like a second or two before, so that the world didn't take them. But she doesn't end up going through with it at the very end. Do you guys think she would have gone through with it if she actually found her husband, and what circumstances changed her decision at the very, very end?
I feel like that's actually For me, just personally, I make a connection, even though it's honestly probably not what the director had in mind, but I make a connection to kind of like, it has like an Eastern spiritual kind of vibe of like just letting go and letting, you know, the world kind of take you instead of trying to take matters into your own hands and like, you know, fighting against it and just coming to peace and accepting it.
So you think that her deciding not to do... to commit suicide at the end, they both sort of mutually decided, we're going to die in each other's arms and just let the world take it. You think that was...
Yeah.
I think if she would have gotten back to her husband, she would have done it. I mean, it was weird because she was, like, at the store buying, like, groceries.
Yeah.
They were going to have, like, a dinner and then...
Yeah, so, like, but what changed that?
Her constantly running into obstacles of, like, oh, I can't get a car, or, like, oh, she couldn't get a car, couldn't get a hold of her husband, like, got... braided by people on the street. Like, she kept coming back to Patrick, and that like kept happening, and
she kept coming, everything was like stopping her from...
And they made a note, they were like, I mean, I think we made a connection, and she was like, yeah, like they both knew that they did. And completely hate each other. And so I think to that point, I mean, because even when she was like, will you like do the pact with me, she was like, oh, like make me love you, like she wanted a reason or something else to feel still.
And no, I agree with that. It was I think you put into good words though. Every time two characters like leave each other in this movie, you know, there's a sense of like playfulness and sort of like banter, like, hey, we're buds, but the last time that they see each other, it's always...
Well, like,
it's always like a somber exchange. It's really, really, it really shows you like how much these people are pretending to feign that they're doing okay, to feign that everything is still normal and that we're gonna wake up tomorrow. But maybe at the end they're just all kind of accepting that. So the film ends on this beautiful shot. It cuts to silence. The screen cuts to white, and then credits roll. What are we giving the? I know we talked about a lot, but what's our final rating for this movie? Out of five on Letterboxd.
Out of five.
Out of five, I'd have to give it a strong... I've only seen it once. To be honest, this is like one of those films I feel like you have to watch
a couple times
to really grasp it.
Yeah.
Just on the first initial watch, though, I mean, I'm not much of a rating guy. I'm not good at quantifying things.
How about thumbs up, thumbs down?
Just overall thumbs up.
Overall thumbs up.
I would say the main thing that I took away from it is just, basically, I think it's just trying to show how all of these things that, you know, that we think are important and are, like, they only have value because we give them value. Mm-hmm. And that's a curse and a blessing. It's a good thing, and it also points out some of the absurdity in it. But yeah, overall, great movie. Enjoyed it. Looking forward to watching it again someday.
Alexis, final thoughts out of five, or thumbs up or thumbs down. Do whatever the fuck you want.
Out of five, like a four and a half, probably. Yeah. I mean, overall, I thought it was pretty good. I didn't have, like, that many issues with it. I think I'm a little too tired to fully comprehend what happened. So maybe I'd like it more if I was more awake.
On subsequent watch-throughs, I do agree with Paris, personally. It is a movie that needs to be watched a couple times over. It's a piece of art. I enjoyed it. There's lots of things to be interpreted by it. The only thing is, I say it was a little bit cheap production quality, but I can't necessarily fault that for the message that I was still able to get across. I give it a 4 out of 5. But yeah, so that was last night. This has been Cinema Sit Down. Thank you everybody for joining us on our season 2 premiere. Toodles.
See you later.
Toodles.
Deuces.
Guantanamera, Guajira, Guantanamera, Guantanamera.